Okay, so welcome. Welcome, everybody. Thank you for coming. Welcome to the forum. My name is Josh Blank. I'm the faculty director of the Graduate Tax Program, and we're delighted that we have the opportunity to have a tax panel at really the premier event at the law school, which takes place each Wednesday during the semester. Our discussion today is titled Cliffs Forever, Tax Reform and the Future of Fiscal Policy. So why are we here? The fiscal cliff, the prospect of massive budget cuts, these are topics that have been in the news and the mainstream news, not just the tax news, in recent weeks. We hope for a last-minute deal before yet another deadline comes, and this is sort of a regular feeling that we start to have as Americans as part of our normal existence. If you think about what just happened this year, in January, the White House and Congress passed a tax deal in the first days of January, but they really just delayed a big part of the issue, the spending cuts, $1.2 trillion in spending cuts, which, if nothing happens, are scheduled to start to take effect in just 9 days. And these are cuts that the president described yesterday as a meat cleaver, which would affect many elements of the economy. So did Congress make any progress at all in January in enacting the tax legislation? What will happen if the $1.2 trillion in spending cuts sequester goes into effect on March 1st? And is this the right way forward to keep trying to solve our fiscal issues this way? Are there alternatives? This panel will address three questions. First, we'll talk about what happened in January of this year. Question two, what's happening right now as we approach March 1st? And our last question, what should happen next? We'll save time for question and answers at the end, so we'll all have a chance to participate. I'll also say that another reason we're really excited about this particular event is that even if Washington is not ready yet to fully embrace the prospect of tax reform, if serious discussion hasn't happened yet, we'd like to start that discussion here at NYU. So this event is really a kickoff event for this semester. We're going to have a series of programs on tax reform where a prominent economist or a legal scholar or a government official will present a proposal, and the proposal will be followed by comments, either from one of our own faculty or one of our alumni. And you'll be getting emails from the Graduate Tax Program later today to tell you about the schedule for these events, but this is the start, hopefully, to a more fuller conversation that'll happen throughout the semester. So if I could just introduce our esteemed panel, I know you may know some of them. Sitting right next to me on my left is David Kamin. He's an assistant professor of law here at the law school. His scholarly interests focus on the federal budget, law and economics, tax law, and policy. Prior to joining NYU, David worked in the White House as special assistant to the president for economic policy. He also worked as special assistant and later advisor to the director of the OMB, where he helped formulate policy for President Obama's first two budgets. David's a graduate of the law school, so we're very happy that he's rejoined us as a member of the faculty. Sitting to my right is Rosanne Altshuler. Rosanne is a professor, and she's the chair of the economics department at Rutgers University. Her research focuses on federal tax policy. It's appeared in numerous journals and books. Rosanne has served as the editor of the National Tax Journal and a member of the board of directors of the National Tax Association. She's been active in the policy world as well. She's been the director of the Urban Brookings Tax Policy Center, senior economist to the 2005 President's Advisory Panel of Tax Reform, and special advisor to the Joint Committee on Taxation. And last but not least, sitting all the way to my left is Professor Dan Shaviro, who is the Wayne Perry Professor of Taxation here at the law school. His research focuses on budget policy, entitlements, tax law and policy. He's one of the nation's leading legal scholars on tax policy. He's authored numerous scholarly books, including Decoding the U.S. Corporate Tax and Taxes, Spending, and the U.S. Government's March Toward Bankruptcy. He's currently working on a new book, Fixing U.S. International Tax Rules, and he is also the author of a novel, Getting It, which was listed on the Wall Street Journal's 2010 Holiday Gift Guide. So,
my proudest achievement by far,
yes,
by the way.
So more on that topic a different time. For now, we'll start with our first question, what happened in January? And so we'll have some time on this first question, about 20 minutes. And I'd like to start with Rosanne. If you could just describe for all of us the basics of the January tax deal so that we're all on the same page in terms of what happened.
Okay, thank you, and thank you for having me today. I think this is going to be fun. As Josh already said, Congress passed a bill on December 31st at the American Taxpayer Relief Act, avoiding most schedule expirations of various tax cuts, and at the same time implementing a two-month delay on steep discretionary spending cuts, which we're calling the sequester. So what did the act do? Well, it makes most of the tax cuts that we call the Bush tax cuts enacted in 2001 and 2003 permanent, permanently patches the alternative minimum tax, extends enhancements to individual income tax credits that were originally enacted in the 2009 stimulus legislation for 5 years, makes the temporary $5 million estate tax exemption permanent, with inflation adjustments going forward from 2011, and imposes a 40% estate tax rate, and temporarily extends certain other tax provisions. In other words, it temporarily extends extenders. The biggies there are the deduction for state and local sales taxes paid on the individual side and the R&E credit, the research and experimentation credit on the business side. What else happened in the deal? The payroll tax holiday expired, and there was temporary extension of unemployment insurance benefits. So as a result of all of this, everybody's paying more in taxes, and everybody is because of the payroll tax holiday expiring. But it's especially true in terms of paying more taxes for the very wealthy. But what do I mean by the very wealthy? Who's really getting hit? Well, it turns out it's less than 1%. It's 0.7%, according to the Tax Policy Center, of taxpayers that are affected by the individual income tax and estate tax provisions. So let me just give a little bit more detail on this, go through the elements quickly. So on payroll taxes, the payroll tax rate on employees has been 4.2% for the past 2 years. As of January 1st, it went to 6.2%, so all of you that are actually working saw your wages go down, your earnings go down. On income taxes, what happened here was that the Republicans accepted higher tax rates for the wealthiest Americans. Democrats accepted a higher threshold for how much income would face those higher rates. President Obama broke his vow to raise taxes on annual household income over $250,000 and individual income over $200,000. So what happened was that the tax rates went up, the Bush tax cuts expired, only for individuals with income over $400,000 and families earning more than $450,000. So this was, Obama had campaigned on this being for people with families making $250,000 or more. So for them, the Bush tax cut era tax cuts expire, and the top rate for them goes from 35% to 39.6%. Just a funny little story, this is only somebody at Tax Policy Center would have looked at this closely. There's now a tax bracket that's less than $2,000 wide. To be precise, it's $1,650 wide. So for single taxpayers making more than about $398,000 and less than $400,000, they pay 35%, and there's about 500 of them. So Howard Gleckman of Tax Policy Center wrote in his blog, given the money these folks make, it does create some interesting social opportunities. They could, all the singles in the 35% bracket could be invited to a nice dinner. They'd certainly fit into a hotel ballroom. So that's what happened on the individual income taxes. On investment income, tax rates on long-term capital gains and dividends go up to 20% from 15%, but that's only for people above that $400,000 a year threshold. Okay, and what do I mean by capital gains and dividends rates even going up? Well, the Bush tax cuts would have kept the top rate at 15% for long-term capital gains and for dividends. If the Bush tax cuts had been allowed to expire, long-term capital gains would have been 20%, which they are now for the people at the top of the distribution, and qualified dividends would have been taxed as ordinary income. But instead, that's capped at 20%. Just as an aside, people should be aware that under the Affordable Care Act, households with incomes above $250,000, married above $250,000, will also pay an additional 3.8% tax on capital gains, dividends, and interest income. Then I'll go quickly through the other stuff. Personal exemptions and certain itemized deductions, this is PEP and PEAS, have returned. So these are phase-outs of the personal exemption and itemized deductions. These phase-outs had actually phased out, but now we put them back in, okay? In terms of the estate tax, that's something else that had gone away but then came back and now is going to be back permanently. So it's a $5 million exemption with the 40% rate. The AMT, as I said, is going to be patched. That's saving almost 30 million middle-class taxpayers from paying an average of about $3,700 in extra tax. The thing about people being all excited about the AMT being patched, of course, everybody on the panel thinks that, thinks that that's the right thing, but most people didn't ever think that they were going to be hit by the tax, so they're not as thankful, I don't think, because they don't think they would have ever had to pay it. Then there was the extension of some of the 2009 tax credits. These really are at the low end, and then for education. And then they did deal with extenders. These are tax provisions that expire every year, but at the end of the year, they get extended. So it helps like Puerto Rican rum distributors and NASCAR owners and people with plug-in electric vehicles. Most of those were extended, guess what, for another year. The last thing is if we don't have PowerPoint, but what you would see is that really all of this is who gets hit are the people that are making $400,000 a year or more. So that's where, and there on average, their rates are going to go up by about, their average tax rate goes up by about 4.5 percentage points. So that's the story on the tax side. That's what happened with the taxes.
Well, thanks. That's extremely helpful and concise. If we now just turn to thinking about revenue, if I could turn to David, if we analyze the January deal in terms of our revenue needs for the next 10 years, how did Congress do?
Well, so first let me address what they did, and then maybe we can begin talking, and I imagine that we'll probably return to the subject later in the panel, exactly how they did relative to what they should have done. So the tax increases that Rosanne just described total about $600 to $700 billion through 2022. $600 to $700 depends on what baseline you use. It's a long, complicated story. We don't have to go there, but it's about $600 to $700 billion. If you put it relative to the economy, it's around 0.4% of the economy. Over the next decade. Now, I think first thing, it can be helpful to think of that relative to the size of the tax cuts that were actually extended. So the tax cuts that were allowed to expire represented about one-fifth of the total size of the 2001 and 2003 tax cuts, which were just made permanent. So the vast majority of the 2001 and 2003 tax cuts were just made permanent, put into law. We can also think about it in terms of where this was relative to what different policymakers had demanded. So President Obama had said that he wanted $1.6 trillion as part of a deficit reduction package. This was obviously not the comprehensive package that people were envisioning. This was $600 to $700 billion. Obviously, on the other side, Speaker Boehner and the Republican leadership wanted no tax increases, and in fact, potentially wanted tax cuts relative to where we were. So then, in terms of like, is this enough? I would tend to think no. So even with these tax cuts and tax increases in place and on the current budget trajectory, we still will have deficits which are well north of what is required to stabilize the debt as a share of the economy over the next decade, which is probably the minimum of what we want to do once the economy recovers. In terms of the trade-offs, obviously, cutting deficits can be done through cutting spending and raising revenues. I think that if you look at the various packages, it will be very difficult, if not impossible, to achieve a package that is acceptable and, you know, sort of allows the investments we need and actually is even politically saleable, that doesn't involve at least some additional revenue increases over the next 10 years if we are get the deficits under control.
Great. Well, I think if we want to just get to a more granular level, and maybe some of these topics will be more familiar to our students who are studying the technical rules, if we think about the three main elements that Rosanne described, the rates, investment income and the estate tax. I think it would be interesting to hear everyone's thoughts on those three elements, rates, investment income, and estate tax. And you can answer this however you like, whether from a policy perspective or revenue needs. Maybe Dan, if we could start with you. What are your thoughts on the three major elements of the deal?
Okay, first of all, on rates, I think the first thing, the sort of top line thing I'm going to say is I think that the consensus, the bipartisan consensus of the last 25 or 30 years that we really need to have the rates in individuals come down is dead. That consensus is not with us anymore, and I say I would agree that it should be dead. Obviously, one side still wants the rates to come down, but there's no longer a consensus on the Democratic side of the aisle, certainly, that the rates should come down. There are a lot of reasons for that. I'll get to them in a moment. But just to show you how the intellectual climate has changed, this may have nothing to do with what to expect politically, but I run a tax policy colloquium. We have a paper next Tuesday with a very famous economist, Peter Diamond, actually won the Nobel Prize coming. He's saying that the top rate on individuals should be 70%. That's not the sort of thing we've heard from an economist, a major economist for the last 30 years. Now, by the way, in the current, as we've heard, the top rate for individuals went up to 39.6. It's probably better seen as being a little above 40, and that's just federal, because the so-called P's phase out, not to get into the details of it, but that's a phase out that for most people never ends. So it really just is, for most people up there, it's really a permanently higher rate. Now, why would some people today, certainly not everyone, be saying the rate should be higher? Well, one reason is obviously the budgetary reason that we kind of need more revenues. Another is, a second reason I think is the concern that many people have, not everyone, but certainly many people, about high-end income inequality and about the extreme concentration of income and wealth at the very top of the spectrum, which you can see as a problem depending on what broader views you take. And another is, it's kind of thought that rates up there are potentially more feasible than people thought they were at one time. One important point is that it appears that so-called short-term labor supply responses aren't that great. In other words, once you're kind of you're a high-priced lawyer or a higher-priced entrepreneur or business person, it appears there's little short-term response to high rates in terms of working or earning a lot less. There may be a more serious long-term response. For example, if you guys were still in high school or college and you're deciding whether to, you know, what type of future to have, it's possible that in a very high-rate environment you would have thought about it differently than you actually did. So there's that issue. And the other thing is, it's thought that the other big problem with high rates is people, they don't adjust their labor supply, or sometimes they just work, I mean, they tax plan more. But there's probably some progress we could make on the tax planning front to kind of reduce, though not eliminate, the opportunities that are available there. The one last thing I'll say is that there, of course, the Obama administration agreed with the Republicans very heartily that there should be absolutely no rate increase on anyone below the very top of the income scale, and for reasons David was laying out about the long-term budgetary picture, and really the cost of government programs that everyone, really just about everyone, or maybe 98% of the political spectrum actually supports, relating in particular to seniors and healthcare and so forth. It's clear we need more revenue from the bottom 99% as well, and that came this time around just from the expiration of the payroll tax holiday. Try to be a little quicker on the other two issues, investment income and estate tax. The tax on investment income did go up significantly, both the 15 to the 20%. Also, there's a Medicare kind of add-on tax that was enacted with the Obama health care, but that's taking effect. That adds 3.8%. Taxing investment income more heavily raises a bunch of issues. Now, one thing, it's really concentrated in the high end of the scale, so you get kind of a big distributional payoff for it. And the second point is that very often what we see showing up as investment income actually isn't. It's really labor income. And a classic example is the whole dispute about carried interest. Or recall, there's this guy named Romney. I haven't heard about him for months, but he used to be well known. He was getting all his labor income from when he was a hedge fund manager at capital gains rates. But when you try to tax investment income at a high rate, you run into a lot of problems. It's relatively easy to tax plan, kind of in theory. You should be able to get your taxable income from investments to zero if you're very rich, because you hold winners and sell losers, you borrow against things that aren't generating current tax liability and so forth. And then, of course, when you die, the tax on appreciation goes away with a step-up in basis of death. it's kind of very problematic to tax. There's just a lot of tax planning flexibility, which makes it not that desirable to tax investment income at a high rate. In addition, you sometimes have genuine questions of how much you want to. For example, if you're actually collecting the tax at the corporate level, which often doesn't happen, you may not be that enthusiastic, or maybe shouldn't be that enthusiastic, about taxing again when dividends are paid or when the shareholders sell. So obviously that depends on how well the corporate tax is working. So it's kind of, it's a natural place for them to have looked. I'm a little more uneasy about it myself than about the rate going up in general. Finally, in the estate tax, it's funny, for years Congress had a racket going where they were kind of, really maybe both sides were kind of extorting campaign contributions, you might say, if you wanted to be a little cynical about it. Because since the fate of the estate tax wasn't known, you kind of had to keep giving money to keep your viewpoint before the Congress. I think it was probably terrible for planners, or at least unpleasant. They finally sort of resolved it, and I would imagine what they did is fairly stable. The estate tax is an instrument that actually has some, I used to be quite skeptical about it myself, and I still, a lot of planning opportunities, but one of the, there are actually some interesting efficiency arguments why it's a good tool to use, which is that although there are a lot of tax planning tricks like perpetual trusts and the like people can do against it, it's really, in some ways, because people don't like thinking about death and because they sometimes leave bequests just because they couldn't figure out what to do with the money or they're insuring against living too long, it can actually be in some settings a surprisingly efficient way to raise that doesn't generate much in real responses to avoid it, like working less compared to income taxes. It can actually be an appealing way to try to raise some revenue from the very top end if you can address some of the planning issues. But one thing that happened, now the estate tax now is only going to apply to an estimated 0.7% of estates. So it's actually not that big a player on the scene anymore, or it's only for a few people. One, I think, lost opportunity that was really a mistake was when they thought they were going to repeal the estate tax, there was some thought of quasi-partially getting rid of 1014, the step-up in basis of death, on the view that if we're not taxing you in the estate, we might as well not let you get the step-up in basis. In many ways, to kind of have death be a realization event where you're taxed on the gain or loss would be a very wise reform, especially since almost no one is facing the estate tax when they die anymore. Among other things, it would reduce the lock-in. You kind of have no reason to sell appreciated assets when you're still alive because the tax will simply go away when you die. If the tax were inevitable at death, I think that would reduce lock-in. There'd be both efficiency gains from that and revenue gains. It's unfortunate that's gotten no attention in Washington because it's actually a very good direction to go in.
So, so we have a few minutes left in this segment, and I want to make I want to make sure I get the views of our other panelists. David, can you tell us how you think Congress did on the three elements, rates, investment income, and estate tax?
Sure. So taking a somewhat different tact from Dan. So Dan spoke about the fact that there's been an intellectual progression on rates, at least sort of on the progressive end, that now says that we don't necessarily want reform that lowers rates. And to add a little bit to that, there was actually an interesting political progression as well over the last year and a half that maybe for other reasons mirrored the longer intellectual progression. Because if you look back at the 2011 negotiations around the budget, at the time, Democrats were certainly more open to a deal which would involve either somewhat lower rates than were in place at the time, so something a little below the 35% rate, or a deal at 35%. You didn't see rhetoric coming from the progressive end or from Democratic leadership saying that they would not accept a deal that didn't have a rate that rose. That changed after the 2012 election. And you saw Obama, for instance, saying he would veto any deal that didn't have an increase in rates, not just an increase in taxes, an increase in rates. So I think that progression happened for a couple reasons. They might have been reading Peter Diamond, but I think that's probably unlikely. So first, there was obviously an election. An election changes things. I think there was also, on top of that, and here you might say I'm giving too much credit to places like Tax Policy Center, but I don't think I am. I think that people came to better understand the actual revenue constraints in tax reform. and how much you lose when you lower rates and how much you can gain when you try to broaden the base by cutting back tax expenditures. The truth is, when the negotiations were happening back in 2011, you might think that there everyone would have run all their tables and people at Treasury would be coming in with, like, this is exactly how you would do it. I don't think that was actually happening at the time. I think people were more negotiating in the face of ignorance. By 2012, there had been a lot more analysis from places like the Tax Policy Center, also I think probably more internal analysis, both on the Hill and from Treasury. And I think it became increasingly evident that it would be extraordinarily difficult to hit the revenue targets that certainly Democrats wanted without a rate going up. It's not to say it's impossible, so you could probably do an intellectual exercise where you manage to cut back tax expenditures sufficiently, that you could have a 35% rate or lower and also increase revenue. But when you begin ticking through the various tax expenditures that would have to be cut, I think there came to be a realization that that looked impossible. And so I think that something that was demanded, one of the reasons why rates became such a demand in the last negotiation is because to hit the revenue levels they wanted, they thought that it would be impossible without rates going up. So look, I actually think that the rate going up was a significant deal. I actually do think that was a relatively big deal. If looking at it glass half full, it means, oh, we just have the easy part left. Republicans kind of, you know, they're not as averse to cutting tax expenditures because it's actually a form of cutting spending. That's the glass half full. The hard part's over. Now we get to do tax expenditures. I'm sure others will say why that may be somewhat unrealistic, but still, that's a glass half full approach. On investment income, the one thing I will say is that I do think that, as Dan was indicating, we are getting to a point where, unless we begin to fundamentally reform how we treat investment income, certainly when it comes to capital gains, we're going to begin pushing on a string. It seems unlikely to me that we're going to get capital gains rates much higher than they are today. That's in part because places like the Joint Committee on Taxation will actually begin to show you with revenue loss once you have a capital gains rate above 28%, or roughly in that area. And that's because they assume people reduce their realizations so much. So when you're up on the Hill, when you begin getting a score back saying that you're going to actually do revenue loss when you're increasing a tax rate, it doesn't seem likely that you're going to go down that route. So it seems to me, certainly when it comes to capital gains, unless they're looking at more fundamental reforms at how we tax capital income going away from realizations, it's going to be hard to push on that particular string. And finally, when it comes to the estate tax, the only thing I will say, Dan, I have good news for you. It turns out the Bull-Simpson Commission actually included realization at death in their plan. Okay. It just turns out no one knew they did it. including themselves, generally. You have to talk to people who are actually analyzing to realizing that was part of their revenue. And I would say that's actually one of the things that people began to realize how unrealistic those kinds of tax reform plans were when they began to realize things like that, which would be really big deals, which Dan loves, but it turns out in D.C. would be completely toxic, were included. And then when people began going through, they realized plans like that may be very hard to make them work.
Thanks. And finally, Rosanne.
Okay, I'll try to be brief. I think I will be brief. I would have liked to have seen Obama win on the $250,000 threshold. I think the rates going up were, as David said, in some sense, what David's saying is it was easier than to get the revenue that way than to try to attack the sacred cows of tax expenditures, because there is revenue there. So that was, I guess it, David's arguing it's a necessity. It sold politically for Obama because of what's been going on with the income distribution and again, this intellectual progression that rates could actually be higher. I just wonder how much higher individual tax rates could be. The 70%, I know that Dan's not putting that out there as a serious proposal, just saying that this is something that
I think of it as broadening the intellectual space of debate. Really.
Exactly, broadening the. But one of the things that I worry about is then what happens with the corporate rate and the differential. And I'm not talking about between 70%. I'm talking about when you get up, above a top rate of 40% or so. So that's, I think. My specialty is corporate tax reform, so that's something that I worry about and why I think you're going to have to do both together. On investment income, I think that going after the higher rates, I agree with David. It's too bad that, well, I'd like to see higher rates. The question is, where should we be taxing the returns to capital income. At what level? At the right now, we tax it at the corporate level and at the individual level. And capital income, as we know, at the corporate level is very, very mobile, and it's only getting more mobile. So my view for a while has been that what we should do is reduce the rate on corporations. Reduce the rate that we're taxing the returns to capital income at the corporate level and raise it at the individual level. And I thought that was a nice reform to pay for lowering the corporate tax rate. But now this deal takes that away because the top rate goes to 20%. I agree. I don't see that going any further. It's good to see the estate tax have some resolution. I don't have really much more to add on that.
Well, let's move on to question two, and this is the one that's on our minds right now. What is happening now? Even in the mainstream press, you hear lots of stories about people who are very anxious about the coming deadline. As I said, we're 9 days away now from March 1st. So, David, if I could turn to you, if you could just give us just a couple of minutes of an overview of what is sequester, and if you could talk a little bit about the debt limit, and just sort of set the framework in terms of what's happening right now.
Sure. And I'll start with the story of the origins of sequester, which turns out right now is a hot political topic. So I'm going to give my version of the story, but you should go look it up. It turns out everyone has a version of the origins of sequester, including an op-ed in the Wall Street Journal, I think, today by Boehner. So the origin. So everyone can agree when it was enacted into law. It was enacted into law in a bipartisan deal that everyone voted for and the president signed. Not everyone, but a lot of people voted for and the president signed in the Budget Control Act in 2011. So everyone can agree what the Budget Act of 2011, the Budget Control Act of 2011 was trying to avoid. It was trying to avoid the U.S. Defaulting, or at least selectively defaulting, or we could use the word whatever describes it, on the debt. We were up against the debt limit in July of 2011, going into August of 2011, and this was the deal that temporarily solved that. So how did it solve that? So the Budget Control Act contained a set of discretionary caps that capped discretionary spending, that's spending that's annually appropriated, over a decade, producing around $1 trillion in savings. Now, the problem was that, so that was one thing that it did, but Republicans in the House were saying that for each dollar that they increased the debt limit, they wanted a dollar of spending cuts. That was their line going to the negotiations. And it turns out that $1 trillion of savings, well, so they would agree to $1 trillion debt limit increase, that would not be sufficient to get us through the 2012 election. And the debt limit was a hugely, it took a huge amount of energy. One could say that it did bad things for the economy back in 2011. The administration's position was they did not want to have that same negotiation before the election, especially because there's no reason to think that if you couldn't cut a deal further away for an election, that you'd have a better chance at cutting a deal just before an election. So what happened was you needed to have some way to get the House Republicans to agree to further increase the debt limit beyond just an $1 trillion debt limit increase. So the deal was, okay, we have this thing called a sequester. Turns out there's sort of a bunch of budget nerds who remember that there's a thing called a sequester that was developed back in the mid-80s under Graham Rudman Hollings. And this was an earlier budget deal that had an enforcement mechanism. And so they basically imported this old enforcement mechanism from the mid-1980s to today. And what that enforcement mechanism does is it says that if various things don't happen, if you don't manage to cut spending, we will cut it for you. We will have $1 trillion sequester on top of the $1 trillion in savings that were already under the Budget Control Act. And in this case, they set up a super committee. So the way we could have avoided the sequester is if the super committee had come up with a deficit reduction deal that hit $1.2 trillion. Obviously, super committee failed. So what we have now is sequestration. Now, the sequester, as I think everyone can agree, though no one can agree whose fault it is, was not in fact intended to take place. So it's about $1 trillion over the next 9 years. It falls half on defense, half on non-defense. If it were to go into effect as of March 1st, and right now, so we delayed it in the last deal by a couple months, and so right now it's supposed to go into effect on March 1st, According to new numbers out of the Center on Budget and Policy Priorities, we'd be looking at an immediate cut in defense of about 8%, non-defense of about 5%, and then those numbers go up as you get into 2014 a bit. In terms of the effect on the economy, so looking at what CBO said, it would be a reduction in GDP growth this year in the range of 0.8%. Other people say 0.7%, but it's something around there, around 800,000 jobs across the course of the year. So bottom line is it creates immediate fiscal constraint. It cuts in ways that no one really wants to cut. It doesn't cut particularly logically. It's across the board. It was meant to promote action. And so we now find ourselves up against it. And then the question is, are we going to manage to replace it with any type of bipartisan deal?
And if we could just focus on the deficit for a minute, how much additional deficit reduction would you say we need?
So this number is also somewhat debated. At the end of last year, President Obama said he wanted $1.5 trillion additional deficit reduction. So Center on Budget and Policy Priorities also put out a paper, and frankly, they sort of relate to one another, saying $1.5 trillion of additional deficit reduction. What that does is that stabilizes the debt as a share of the economy under CBO projections over the decade. Other people say we need more. So for instance, Bowles Simpson just put out a plan yesterday that has, I think, about $2.4 trillion of additional deficit reduction and begins reducing the debt as a share of the economy over the next decade. So it's in that range, $1.5 trillion, $2.5 trillion is sort of what would either stabilize or begin to reduce the debt as a share of the economy once we recover.
And actually, if we could just get to the part where I think most of us are interested in, and on the edge of our seats, your predictions about what will happen. What will happen on March 1st? Will sequester actually happen? Will we slip into a recession? Will I get my mail? Will Vice President Biden make an appearance at the last minute to solve this? Why don't we start with Dan, and if you could each just give us a couple of minutes of your predictions about what's going to happen.
I'll talk about that for just a second, then I may want to say something about deficit reduction, how much we need. I think that the sequester, from the standpoint of the players in Washington, there have been some people who have said this online and elsewhere, it's less bad than anything else for them. That doesn't mean for us, but for them, I think for both the Obama administration and the Republicans, partly because you're kind of not blamed for the thing that's already there. There's nothing they can agree to that is less bad, so I think they're just going to let it happen. At some point, if there's enough kicking and screaming, they're going to kick the can down the road probably a bit and just sort of agree to do nothing or not very much. That's actually not the worst outcome in a way, because if you asked me how much deficit reduction we actually need, in one sense I might say none, although I'd be quite surprised to hear myself say that because I've been writing about this issue for years and years. Two points I'd make. The first is that the state of the macroeconomy and the employment situation is kind of a horrendous unfolding national tragedy that's just going on. It's absolutely stunning that the political system apparently, quote, doesn't care and thinks that that's fine. If there's one thing that there's this guy, my generation grew up and you've kind of heard this name, this guy Nixon, Richard Nixon. There's one thing Richard Nixon thought he knew is that you can never afford to have unemployment when you're running for president if you're going to be blamed for it. Apparently that's not really true anymore. It tells something about Washington that it doesn't really seem to matter that much, even though, for example, Romney tried to base some of his campaign on it. It turns out to be very low cost for politicians, it seems, to have, or surprisingly low cost, to have high unemployment, although socially it's really a disastrous thing. Now, I think we should do something about the deficit in the sense that we have it's really not 1 year's deficit that matters. That would be like saying that students in law school, the fact that you have a deficit this year because you're paying tuition and you're not working most of the year, that's a problem. Of course, it's not a problem if you're going to go okay in the long run. But the long-term measure, the so-called fiscal gap, shows that the U.S. has serious inadequacy of revenue to meet spending over the long run. So in a rational political world, point one, we decide right away what to do about it. We'd announce how we're going to try to solve it. Point two, leaving aside the macroeconomy and the job situation, we'd probably start implementing it right away. To give an example, why would you want to cut Medicare a lot in 20 years and not at all today, as opposed to cutting it a little bit both times, so that you kind of impose, in some sense, equal pain on today's seniors and future seniors? But the problem is, you really need the ability to have a kind of a rational political system that can make stable, sensible deals, and I don't think we have that right now. I think if the Republicans today were similar to the Republicans in the Reagan and Bush 1 years, a deal could be made, and maybe it would be made. But I think the Democrats now are going to kind of logically conclude they really can't make deals with the Republicans because the Republicans won't stick to any deal, won't negotiate in good faith or make good deals. I think I can state as fact that that's the Democratic view. Obviously, views will differ on whether it's a correct view. So although I would like to start addressing the fiscal gap right away, I think politically we have to get to a different place than we are in addition to macroeconomically. So I kind of think there's really no point to doing anything about it just now.
So David, your predictions?
So I guess first, predictions are always dangerous because of course like you make them and then you're wrong. But so right now, I mean, it seems like the general prediction, I have a hard time disagreeing with it, is that it seems like the sequester will actually go into place as of March 1st. And, you know, look, unlike with the debt limit, when you do cross over the line, the government has to begin prioritizing payments or delaying payments. There is not going to be, chances are on March 1st, a massive market reaction type of thing. It immediately forces action. However, it seems like it's the type of thing that gradually imposes pain, so they'll negotiate with that in mind. And it's something to keep in mind is there will be other forcing mechanisms as time goes on. So they need the CR, the thing that allows the government to function with just general appropriations, runs out at the end of March. And that's probably going to be the first forcing event. And then we have the debt limit in the background where that will eventually come back into place. And by July or August, they'll probably run out of room there. So there will be another deal. Like that is something that we actually do know. The president will sign a new piece of fiscal legislation into law. It has to happen. They're not going to let the government shut down forever and the debt limit to run out. The question is what it will look like. Unfortunately, I think probably the highest probability is that we go to various short-term fixes over time. That on a it's possible on a year-by-year basis, they turn off sequester. We continue to have negotiations that go on and on. It's certainly the pattern up until now. The hope is that we finally overcome whatever the political barriers that have been in place up till now, because I think everyone can agree, probably the worst case scenario is that. Better to actually maybe kick the can down the road a few years and try again then, or actually come up with an overall deal now, than to do what we're doing, which is basically to budget on a month-to-month basis.
Rosanne.
This is the typical depressing panel that you encounter nowadays that has on the fiscal situation of the United States. So the prediction is that our dysfunctional government will get even more dysfunctional, right, by going to these just kind of kicking for two more months or for 3 months or for 6 months for a year after year after year. It's depressing, but I think what David is predicting, I'll call it a prediction. Sorry, David, is probably true. I think the sequester will happen. What I'm really worried about is the expiration of the continuing resolution, which is on March 27th. And as David said, something will happen. That leads to a government shutdown. What plan will we end up with? I don't know. But it's going to be something, and it is likely going to be something that just, again, puts off the big decisions that we should have been making years and years ago. We saw this happen. We saw this coming. It's been very interesting to be teaching tax. I teach to undergraduates. I teach a course called The Economics of Taxation, and I talk about the expiration of the Bush tax cuts, and we're talking about this crisis coming up or these big changes coming, and the students are just amazed. We saw this coming for 10 years. I mean, how is this possible? And then it wasn't until recently that anything happened. In preparing for this panel, look closely at the February CBO budget forecasts are out, and it's really interesting in terms of how much more do we need. If you look, what they have to do is they have to do forecasts based on current law. So based on current law, this is what really struck me. Total spending is going to be about the same share of the economy in 2023 as it is in 2012. And with the demographics that we're facing, it's hard to imagine that we're really going to be able to get there. So I guess CBO has, 10 years from now, about 3.5%. What would be the deficit as a percentage of GDP?
Under the current law
scenario,
I think it was it goes. I thought it went under 3% for a little bit under current law,
and then goes back up to the end of 10 years. It would be something between 3 and 4%.
Yeah.
but that's under current law that I'm not sure we can, I mean, we certainly, that's kind of a wishful thinking that we could keep spending at that rate. And that's at, with revenues being at a higher percentage than they've been historically. So not sure where we go from there.
Well, with that rosy outlook, maybe we should move to our third segment. And you'll notice nobody mentioned Vice President Biden's potential role, but keep an eye on him. So question three, what should happen next? And this, I think, actually is a great way to end the panel's part of the discussion before we turn to the audience. There are certain terms that get thrown around a lot. They've already happened in this discussion. Tax reform, our revenue needs, and we haven't really taken time to flesh those out. So why don't we start with just an overview of our long-term revenue needs? And for this, I'd like to ask David if you could just give us an overview of, sure. of our long-term needs.
So to do it briefly, one could do a whole presentation on the long-term revenue needs and long-term projection. So right now, revenues are on track under the CBO forecast to be around 19% of GDP by 2015, and then to remain around there through the end of the decade. That's up from around 15 to 16% of GDP right now. So as the economy recovers, we have expiration of the high income tax cuts, expiration of the payroll tax cut, we go from around 15 to 16% up to 19%. So first, I think one thing to think about, how does that compare historically? So over the last 30 to 40 years, revenues have averaged around 18% of the economy. And a lot of people like to look historically because they say, oh, and you know, look, 19% of the economy is actually 1% higher than historically. So should that be enough? Well, let's put it in a, I'll give you the following numbers and then we can judge from there. So under current policies, and this also refers to what Rosanne was saying, and adjust the CBO baseline a little bit, but it actually turns out to be relatively similar. Spending will be around 22 to 23% of the economy around 2020 and going to a few years just after that. Now, how does that compare historically? So compared to the average of the last 30 years, the average is around 21% of GDP, so somewhat higher than the historical average. And this assumes that we do have a ramp down in the wars abroad. We don't get into a new military conflict. It assumes the Budget Control Act caps remain in place. The numbers I was giving actually don't assume sequestration remains in place. All right, so we now have revenues at 19% of GDP. We have spending at 22 to 23% of GDP. First thing to note about that is it already indicates that you probably have a deficit that is too high to actually stabilize the debt as a share of the economy. At that point, your deficit is around 3 to 4% of GDP. If, to stabilize the debt where we have the debt right now, which is a little north of 70% of GDP, you need deficits of 3% or a little below that. Depends on your GDP growth rate. A lot of people target that. We could ask whether that's a meaningful target, but a lot of people try to target that. So we're already starting in a place where deficits are somewhat too large unless we enact new policies. So what happens after that? Social Security will continue to grow after the end of the decade. Actually, not by much. By the end of the decade, we've had a lot of baby boomers have already retired. Social Security would grow by about 0.5% of GDP under CBO projections, which is actually not huge. And so we've already seen the major increase in there by the end of the decade. Now, what happens to Medicare and Medicaid? And this is where the rubber hits the road. It turns out that when you look at Medicare, Medicaid, all the various health programs of the federal and the federal government, the CBO projection, we could talk about its assumptions, a long, long discussion, goes from around 7% of GDP at the end of the decade to 15% of GDP 75 years out. And I know 75 years sounds like a lot of time, but that's what these long-term projections do. An 8 percentage point of GDP jump. So, not surprisingly, if you've got healthcare programs growing like that, you've got Social Security growing somewhat, something's got to give. Either those have to get a lot smaller, discretionary spending needs to get even smaller than it's supposed to be at the end of the decade, which is a record low as a share of the economy, or revenues need to be significantly higher. And so with that, I will end the overview.
Well, and now just to think about tax for a little bit, Dan, can you give us a definition of fundamental tax reform? What does that mean? This is the goal we always seem to be talking about, but what is it? What is fundamental tax reform?
Well, the definition I'm hoping will be accepted more broadly is whatever Shaviro thinks is the right thing to do. And I can change it if I want, and it's still fundamental reform. I don't think that's going to happen, but I'll say what fundamental tax reform is most commonly meant is one of two things. The first is a sort of 1986-style deal where you broaden the base and you lower the rates. I really don't see that happening for a number of reasons. One is that it's just very hard politically. If there's one thing you learn about kind of interest group politics is that people like targeted benefits. Narrow groups like targeted benefits more than general benefits. So it's inherently an uphill fight to say you're going to broaden base and lower the rates. It's not something the political system naturally produces. People start saying, oh my God, I'm losing X. And losers scream more than winners cheer. So it's kind of hard to do inherently. A second question is, it was traditionally defined as burden neutral, I'm sorry, it was as revenue neutral and distribution neutral. But why would you go to enormous lengths to have a revenue-neutral tax reform when we have the long-term fiscal challenges we have? It just doesn't seem like the time when you'd want to do that. Another point is distribution-neutral. It's very hard to cut the rates and have the top not gain ground, especially now that we're... In 1986, they defined distributionally-neutral tax reform at the top as people earning $200,000 or more. Even if you adjust that figure for inflation to be the comparable today, I think today people are very concerned about the top 0.01%, the top 0.1%, and at the very top it's very hard to cut the rates and not have them come out pretty far ahead. Plus, if you have both revenue concerns, need for more revenue, and also concern about distribution at the top, why exactly would you go through this enormous exercise where you cut the rates and you give away all the revenue you would have gained, and we still have the long-term fiscal problem. So I kind of don't see it as really the right way to go these days. Now, obviously, base broadening is another matter, but consider really the two biggest items for individuals. One is home mortgage interest deductions. That's a pretty sacred cow politically. Plus, actually, I myself, although I don't happen to like that deduction, would be a little leery about repealing it cold turkey today when you think about all the mortgages people have that are already potentially underwater. So that's kind of a little tricky. The other big one is employer-provided health insurance. And that, I think, basically every tax policy type from the left to the right agrees, what a stupid idea. If we were doing it all over again, we wouldn't do that. Nonetheless, we've kind of expanded health insurance coverage to more people. And the employer-provided system, just for reasons of history, is the way it's mostly done. You have to be a little bit leery about kicking that stool out from under without at least making sure that health insurance will still be functioning well. And also, so these are areas, I could propose some revenue-raising reforms that would improve the, when I say I could propose them, a lot of other people know that propose the same ones I would, but when you kind of make it rationally designed, you actually raise a little less revenue. It's hard to do politically. I just don't see it happening. Let me mention just two other concepts of fundamental tax reform. One is, and this is one a bunch of academics like me have written about, replacing the income tax with a progressive consumption tax. We could have, and we have had, lots of like fun, at least for the participants, interesting debates about whether that's worth doing. I don't think it's going to happen. I believe it has certain virtues. I don't think it's going to happen. And once again, you'd kind of ask, how much trouble do you want to go to raise no net revenue in today's climate? Finally, there is something I think we're going to get to a little later. This is not really fundamental reform anymore, but there's certainly new tax instruments, things that we haven't had before that could raise a lot of revenue. I'll just name three. One is, again, it's not really fundamental reform. A value-added tax, which I think Rosanne's going to talk about. A second one is something like a carbon tax. Obviously, we've been down the road of that a little bit, and it doesn't seem to be going very far. But a carbon tax is certainly a way of raising revenue that relates to global warming, although actually the global warming benefits really depend on other countries doing it too, not just us. And finally, there's been talk about taxes on the financial sector, such as financial transactions taxes and the like. Whether good or bad, those could raise a lot of revenue. But anyone who thinks that either raising taxes or particularly raising them on banks that are rather powerful politically is going to happen soon, let me know why you think that, because I'm not extremely, I don't consider it extremely likely.
And one more important question as we think about what should happen next, is really focused on something that Rosanne had mentioned earlier as you talked about your interest in corporate taxation, the relationship between individual tax reform and corporate tax reform. Can these occur separately, or does, if we want to call it fundamental tax reform, does it have to include both? Do they both have to happen at the same time, or is it possible, do you think, for the reform to happen separately?
A while ago, a couple years ago, I thought that we could actually do corporate tax reform without doing individual tax reform at the same time. And I've increasingly come to believe that we're going to have to do both together. President Obama has said that he's willing to consider corporate tax reforms, but he only would consider ones that are revenue neutral. And we can talk about what he means by revenue neutral, but within the corporate sector. So he's not going to allow for a corporate tax reform that would raise less revenue. And so a couple problems. The major problem here is that about half of business receipts come through flow-through entities that are not subject to the corporate tax. And so anything that you would do on the corporate side, so get rid of accelerated depreciation, for instance, is also going to affect S corporations. It's going to affect pass-through corporations. And that's been a big stumbling block. And I think that's what's kept us from going forward. But now let's, and I think that's one of the reasons why we're going to have to do everything all at once. But now let's just think for a second about a revenue-neutral corporate tax reform. Well, what's the idea? I mean, the idea is to get down the corporate tax rate. So how much can you buy down the corporate tax rate? My colleague Eric Toder at the Tax Policy Center did some really rough back-of-the-envelope calculations, and he said, look, if you get rid of all of the corporate tax expenditures, all of the special exclusions, deductions, et cetera, you could get the corporate rate from 35% to 25%, but that's not going to happen, okay? So let's start adding things back in. So let's add back in deferral. Under deferral, U.S. multinationals don't have to pay taxes on the income they earn abroad until they bring it back. It's not likely that we're going to get rid of deferral, so let's add that back in. Then we get the rate down to 26%. Well, I don't really see us doing anything to accelerated depreciation or R&E expensing. So let's add that back in. We're at 31.5%. If we were to just get rid of the targeted preferences, the ones that you that really look egregious, that why are we doing these, you get down to 33%. The Obama budget gets us down to 33.5%. So it's just not clear what corporate tax reform on its own is able to do, I mean, if it's not able to lower the rate significantly. So that's my answer.
Great. Well, I know we've got a few minutes left in this segment. Maybe the best way to end it is by doing this. If you could each take just a few minutes and tell us what's at the top of your wish list. If there was one thing that Congress and the administration would do in terms of tax reform, what would it be? What's at the top of your list? Rosanne, I'll start with you.
Well, at the top of, I think that all roads lead us to having a value-added tax. And so just to keep things short, I'll just lay that out. I think that our future revenue needs are going to require that we look like every other country that's running the type of social programs that we're going to be running. And basically every other country in the world that you can name in this room, okay, I challenge you that this, has a value-added tax. It's an efficient tax. And we could adopt best practices. We could protect people at the end of at the bottom of the distribution. We can't make it exactly distributionally neutral, as Dan. This is a problem because of the people at the top. But I'm not saying replace the income tax with the value-added tax. There would still be the income tax that we can use as an instrument. So I'd like us to start thinking. And I think there is serious talk about a VAT. People are going to throw their hands up, I'm sure, but when I mentioned a VAT, like back in 2005 when I started thinking about this on the president's tax reform, if I said the word VAT, I would just get booed out of the room, just basically carried out of the room, like the crazy VAT lady. But now I don't think that's going to happen. It doesn't happen in Washington anymore. So,
great. And Dan?
I probably don't have anything to add to it. I've mentioned a bunch of things before, like Section 1014, thinking about a carbon tax. I'd agree that VAT should be in the list. Thinking about banks and maybe thinking about some more egregious tax preferences. Beyond that, I don't really have anything more to add.
David?
So I'm going to switch the question just slightly so that I don't have to give what I actually would mm-hmm. want most in the face of the earth, because I know probably that will never happen. But I do think that we often overlook the parts of the current system, things that are already part of current law, that can potentially produce significantly more revenue over time. And I do think the amount of revenue that can be produced is a big deal just because of the fiscal constraints we face. So right now, already in the current system, we have a excise tax on high premium healthcare plans that's supposed to go into place in 2018. This is part of healthcare reform. And so addressing Dan's issue of the health exclusion we can talk about whether it's a good substitute or not, but is at least a form of substitute for limiting the health exclusion. That's a tax that, if it goes into place, would actually gradually raise more and more revenue over time, because the threshold at which it comes in place is indexed to inflation and not healthcare cost growth. So that's something that's part of the current system that actually has the potential to raise significantly more revenue over a long period of time, and also potentially improve efficiency. I think if we look at our current system, in the current system, for instance, we index to inflation and not real income growth. So if all goes well and we actually do have real income growth over time, the income tax system potentially can raise more revenue as time goes on. We also have certain thresholds which, for better or worse, are not indexed to inflation. Things like the 3.8% tax on investment income was $250,000, not indexed to inflation. So in part, I hope we get new revenue. I think we need it over the next 10 years. I think we also need to be focused on protecting those elements of the system that have the potential to gradually phase in and raise significantly more revenue over time.
Well, you piqued our interest with what you would most want on the face of the earth,
yeah.
But I'll give you one last chance.
It's
going to stay secret.
It's a secret right now.
Fair enough. Okay, so we have time for questions from the audience. Who wants to start? Oh, great. And I don't know if we've got a microphone. Oh, we do have a microphone there in the back. Yeah. So why don't we start in the very back of the room, and then we can walk forward. And if you could introduce yourself.
My name is Bill Rapp. I finished an LL.M. in tax here. 2011. I teach management at the New University of New Jersey Institute of Technology, and I'm interested in what the panel thinks about a Tobin tax, which is actually being introduced in Europe, so this wouldn't be a case of arbitrage. And the other thing is, what about increasing royalties on oil exploration and things as an alternative to carbon tax?
Well, I'll just talk about the FTT, the Tobin tax, financial transaction tax. I wrote about that recently because it turned out I could get a free trip to Amsterdam if I did. I'm somewhat of a skeptic about it. I'm somewhat of a skeptic about it. It's a tax on the gross amounts sold in stock sales. And it's, I think the best argument for it really is that people spend too much time trying to get stock profits by being one quarter of a second before someone else and figuring out the direction of price movement. But it is a gross tax. It's very subject to concern, both to geographical migration, concern about derivatives. It's not quite clear. It's pitched as a tax on some ill, like a pollution tax. But it's not quite clear exactly what the ill is. So I'm not a huge fan of this tax, although you always have to ask the question, compared to what? I certainly think there are plenty of worse ideas floating around there. I don't know if someone else wants to talk about the other part.
So on financial transaction tax, I tend to agree with Dan. On the other part, on oil revenues, I will say, so it's often discussed in D.C., like how much can you get from offshore leases. Right now we do. There is an auction system. I believe when the federal government wants to, put an oil field somewhere off in the Gulf of Mexico, they do auction it off. So I think the amount of revenue you can get from that is somewhat limited. There was actually some thought of going back because they messed up some auctions back in the 90s. It's potentially that you could try to go back and get at that. Turns out there are some possible legal problems from doing so. So bottom line is maybe we could do it more efficiently, but unfortunately it will probably not be the savior of our fiscal future.
Great. So we had more hands. I think Rebecca had a question. And if you could just introduce yourself.
Yeah. Hi, Rebecca Walser. I'm finishing the LLM here. I had a question specifically about the VAT, because I know it was talked about a good year ago and then it was kind of disappeared. The question is, you know, you make a reference that this is, we're the only country that doesn't have one, but we're also the only country I can think of off the top of my head that has 50 different states that all have their own sales tax and consider that to be their domain. And if I was to compare the United States to, say, the EU, I would say a state is similar to a country, where each country can, you know, has its own VAT, but each state has its own sales tax. I think that's going to be a real big pushback, specifically on the state level, and also a hard sell maybe to the American public that we're going to still have an income tax, and also now a sales tax of your state level, and also now a federal sales tax, which is what the VAT actually is in essence. So how could you, what could you say to that?
Okay, so Canada had provincial sales taxes. So they're real. It's really good to look at Canada, because they've done some good things over there. And they had provincial sales taxes. Not all of the provinces had them, but most of them did. And it turned out to it's still a little bit messy, but it works. And if you talk to Canadian public finance specialists, they say there really wasn't a big problem. So for instance, what Quebec did is they adopted the same base, I think. I could be wrong on this, but they collect the federal VAT and give it to they call it a GST. It's not good to call it a VAT, and then they remit it to the federal government. Some other provinces just adopted the same base and have the federal government give them the money back. I think Australia had a similar situation. As far as the states are concerned, I think it would be good for the states. The states have terrible, awful sales taxes. Yes, they're going to be kicking and screaming, but they have terrible, terrible sales taxes with all sorts of exemptions that don't make sense, all sorts of holes. And so it might be a good, many of us are arguing that it would be actually good for them, because they could adopt a much better base. So I think that the Canadian experience, and I think Australia also shows that this could happen. In terms of being a hard sell, it's certainly not going to be easy. But one argument that I don't understand is businesses saying, oh my God, we're going to have to pay this extra tax. They do, well, first of all, any of them that operate multinationally, I mean, all the multi, they already have big groups within their corporations that do this. We can handle it. So, and one of the things about the VAT is that we can adopt best practices from around the world. It's not a new tax. So,
New Zealand is the best one, by the way.
Yeah, New Zealand has that. New Zealand, you always want to look at New Zealand, it turns out, and Canada is not a bad place to look either.
And just before I go to other questions, if I could ask you, Rosanne, to just talk a little bit about progressivity. And I know many people probably are thinking about the obstacles that a VAT presents in terms of progressivity. So how in a nutshell do you deal with that?
You would have refundable credits. So what Canada did is refundable credits as based on family size that phase out with income. And we can use technology to our advantage here. Now, again, I haven't studied this very, very closely, but I am sure that we could load up cards that would be able that we would use to help at the bottom end. The thing that you don't want to do is something like exempt bread, exempt food, because you know everybody. We had lunch together today. We all ate bread and food. Okay, and none of us, I don't think any of us are at the bottom of the income distribution. So that's just a very inefficient way.
It'd be nice for me when I shop at Whole Foods if it was exempted.
Exactly, that would be really great. So I think that's, and the person to go to on this is Michael Gratz, who's looked at it very carefully. So we looked at it back in 2005, we did distributional analysis. There is a problem at the very top, but there is a possibility of making this close to what you'd like it to be. And then you can just, at the top, you can do something with rates. You have to take the entire income tax system together.
And just as a plug, one of our future programs will be on consumption tax, and there will be a proposal, but that's for later in the term. There were more hands. Great. I think Lee, you had a question. If we could just have the microphone up to the front. If you could just introduce yourself.
Lee Shepherd from Tax Notes. A couple of observations with some questions mixed in. I think the whole deficit thing is kind of overblown. And you guys give me the correct number, but the debt is what, 70% of GDP right now? Okay, and it's like sort of heading to 90, right?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, and the deficit is 3-4% of GDP? And what's the problem with that if we're borrowing in our own currency? and lots of Chinese and Japanese are willing to hold our paper for no interest whatsoever?
Well, the problem over the long run is that it's projected as exploding over the long run. Right. I think you would make a good point about the current scenario.
Well, we're not Italy. Okay, we're politically paralyzed and corrupt, okay? But we're not Italy in the sense that we've got some currency that's not in our control that we're borrowing in, and we're not, you know, the numbers on the page that you folks are looking at on the deficit are not even the whole story anyway, because we do stuff that we monetize, okay? Since Vietnam, we have actually, I think Vietnam was monetized too, but we monetize all our little military, big military adventures. So that's $2-3 trillion for Iraq and Afghanistan that we monetized, okay? We monetized all but a couple of $1 trillion of the bank bailouts, okay? So we, if we want to create money for something, we can do that. And it's kind of weird to me to say, well, here's our formal budget and our taxes. And our formal budget is a quarter discretionary, about a quarter Medicare, a quarter Medicaid, and a quarter military. And that's the regular military, not the adventures, okay? And we're all getting in a fight. And the Social Security part is pretty much paying for itself, even though there aren't separate accounts. So then we're worried about the other stuff. But where does it say, well, we can't monetize that too?
Now, if you look at the four, I mean, I'm really on your side of this, that we shouldn't be doing crazy things or things that aren't really leading to solution now. But over the long run, it's driven by healthcare growth more than anything else. The long run, it is projected to go beyond the point that we can just issue debt to the Chinese.
So I would say a couple things. So first, I think that the fact that, and I tend to agree with Dan also, I agree with you to a great degree, that right now, like, the deficit issue should not be the number one issue facing, like, the economy right now. And in fact, but that doesn't mean we don't need to take action. Because if we take no action right now, we're gonna have upfront austerity. That is the fundamental problem of sequestration, right? Like, and then also the problem of the fiscal cliff we faced in January was this sudden change in tax rates and a sudden change in spending that would create a large upfront austerity, which we do not want in the current economic circumstances. So we do need to in some way turn, I mean, not we don't need to, it would be good if we could turn off the sequestration, because right, what we don't need for the economy right now is $85 billion in upfront spending cuts. So I think that's number one. I think you're right. So, you know, I would say that first, half is non-defense, half is defense under sequestration. Second, when you're faced with like a large output gap, when you have people who are out of work, what you don't like, whether it's military spending or whether it's other kinds of spending, what you don't want to do is a sudden cut in it when you have high unemployment.
Keynes famously commented that at certain times it's better to pay people to move pits of sand around than to do nothing at all.
Right. And in terms of the long-term trajectory, I think there's good reason to have, like, we could talk for a long time about it. Obviously, if we have historical health cost growth, I think we could probably agree if we have debt to GDP in 2050 that's 800% of GDP, that's probably going to be a problem. Now, the trajectory of that is highly uncertain. As a lot of people have written right now, we've actually had very low health cost growth over the last several years. And there's like a big debate as to why that's the case, whether it's structural, whether it's the economy or not. And we have a lot of uncertainty as to how the healthcare reforms are going to play out over the next several years. I, for one, am somewhat hopeful that maybe, you know, we have seen a change in long-term health cost growth, which will mean that our long-term picture is a lot better than we might otherwise think. But I think I tend to agree with Dan. If we have what we've seen historically, then there's no doubt that we will have to make significant changes. And with that said, there's a lot of uncertainty about the long-term trajectory.
So I think we have time for one more question. I saw Josh has a hand up right in front of me. So our final question.
My name's Josh, I'm with the LL.M program. I just had a real quick question for you. I know that you have the benefit of actually talking with an awful lot of the principal players that are involved in this negotiation. I was curious if just your sense, if there's a growing weariness both in the White House and on Capitol Hill to be dealing with this, or do we see this as a great discussion that the principal players are willing to engage in for the next few years, knowing that it is a defining moment in just how we go forward?
Right, so is this fun or horror? What do you say?
Who wants to start? I think, Mike, I'm, I know the least, so I'll just go first and say my, I can only think that they want to move on to other issues, and so it's they're not having fun.
I don't think anyone's having fun with it, but the Republican leadership has to worry about their relationships with the rank and file in Congress and the base, and that's going to be a big constraint on what they can do no matter what they want to do.
I agree they're not having fun. And I think you can actually already see, like, there has been a pivot in the rhetoric of both Republicans and Democrats over the last several months, where other issues are becoming, you know, are coming to the fore, whether it's immigration, whether it's gun control. You know, for the last year or two, the number one issue that was taking up time was fiscal issues in Congress, and it was taking up all the breathing space. In going forward, there's at least some hope. You can see, and both on the Democratic side and I think the Republican side, that they will get to use the political space for other topics. The problem is that they have these other forcing events in between. So I would say that they would prefer not to be spending their time on this. They will be forced to still spend some of their time on this. And so I would say they are certainly not having fun and would like to move on if they could.
By the way, just one closing word is I think it's possible things will get a lot better for our country, but it won't be because of the political system. If it happens, it'll be in spite of it and on the side.
Well, please join me in thanking our panel for a great discussion. And just and thank you all for your questions and for coming. And one last housekeeping item. As I said, if Washington is not willing to fully embrace the tax reform debate yet, hopefully they can be inspired by our colleagues who hang out in Washington. I have an NYU tax hat for each of you to wear home. So here you go.
I was not nerdy enough.
And thank you all for coming. And please check your email and you'll get news about the next tax reform programs. Thanks very much.